so we get y is greater than negative x plus 2. And let's forget about the way it used to look. We use this.
How do you do that?
Just subtracted x from both sides. Okay, so before it looked like x plus y is greater than 2. So if we subtract x from both sides, okay, no more x over here, just got y greater than negative x plus 2.
What did you do? Oh, okay, that's all you did.
Yeah. Well, the reason, instead of writing 2 minus x, I wrote negative x plus 2, I wrote it that way just because it looks like the order m x plus 2. Mm-hmm. All right, the equation, or the inequality in black first. A couple of things. We graph inequalities, a
line.
A line and a
dotted line.
Blacked out.
The blacked out half, exactly.
Oh.
So we got the line with a y-intercept of negative 1, a slope of 1/3 that's going to be over to the right 3 of 1. Well, now what kind of line are we with?
Solid.
A solid line, right? Because we don't want to imply that a point on the line works. Why wouldn't a point on the line work for this inequality, Chris?
Because it's not equal to.
Right, so, and that's what the line is. It is a bunch of points, all the points that make both sides equal. Both sides equal, bad. So, dotted. Dotted line tells us where the blacked out half stops, but it also tells us that points on the line are illegal. They make both sides equal, and that is not something we're trying to do. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Right. There. Yeah, the other direction. Something like that. All right, the second part, blacked out half. How do we know which side, the top or the bottom, to black out? How do we know?
Well, you got, if it, the y is greater or less. Well, if anything's on the line, that next point, whatever.
If anything's on the line, that next point?
Yeah, I don't. Wouldn't it be greater? I mean, wouldn't it be up because y is greater than, so that would be up and go up?
Here, let me give you something to do. Let's try to true that you can count on. Let's test the point. If we're not sure, let's test the point. A nice point, as long as it's not on the line, is 0, 0. So let's test it out. Let's test out 0, 0. 0 for y, 0 for x.
Oh, 0.
Testing it, see if it works. If it does, great. If it doesn't, shade the other side. So y, 0.
It works.
Greater than 0,
minus 1.
Is 0 greater than negative 1?
Yep. Mm-hmm. So
well, and it came from that point. That point must come from blacked out half. So let's just complete the blacked out half. We'll use this, what we know to be correct right now, to help us back up another approach, which would be that y is on the larger side. The y, like the number for y, needs to be bigger than the right side, right, where you plug in x. So whatever x and y you use, the y needs to be bigger. Where do we find big y's?
Big.
Up. Where do we find small y's?
Down.
We want big y's. Y needs to be big. So we find big y's up there. We find small y's down there. Okay. So we've graphed the first inequality. That's just kind of half of the problem. We graph the other. Richard?
So when you, for the fraction, how do you point that? Because I did the opposite way of you go over 1s and up 3. For 1/3.
If we're not sure, then we can always, you know, treat it like the graph of a line and plug in a number. Okay? So you think about it for the black one. If I'm trying to graph this line, okay, first of all, you plug in 0, right? And that gives you the negative 1. 0, 0, negative 1. Okay, now we're going to plug in a number. Do you want to plug in 1 here?
Do I want to?
Would it be easy to multiply these together?
No.
Yeah.
Would it be easier than multiplying 1/3 by 3.
No.
Yeah.
Wait.
No,
well,
no, no.
3
would be easier.
3 would be easier.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
What's 1/3 times 3?
1.
3 is canceled, right? We get 1. If I go to 1 there, I have 1/3 times 1 is 1/3, and it's right. But when I go to graph it, it's a little bit of a hassle. So the x that I want to use with this fraction, because the denominator is 3, the x that I want to use is 3. So that tells me when I come over here, I don't want to go over 1. I don't want to go to x is 1. I want to go over to x is 3.
Oh, okay. So you need the bottoms as well.
And then when I run these numbers 1 minus 1, I get 0. I don't like to remind you, like, oh, you got it in the reverse order and reverse that order, because now we're relying on our memorization.
We have to do the second one, too.
Yeah. Memorization is a bad thing to rely on. Okay, so we've got this other guy. It's going to be kind of hard to see in this blackness, but we got a y-intercept. That looks like about a 2 there. Got a slope of -1. That means we go to the right 1 and down 1. So what kind of line is this going to require? Dotted, because it's not equal. There we go. Now I'm going to shade it in. Shade in that half, which will be above the lower line. Above, right? We want big y values. Big y values come up from up above, not down below.
And then the one that would be just switching to both.
And they're where and they're where?
The mix.
In the mix. Or where they overlap. Would this work? Would this point work? You can see it, this point?
Yep.
And this one?
Yep.
This one?
Yep. This is yellow. Oh, no.
Right, no. Oh, that's only in the yellow or orange, I guess, depending on how you see that color. How about this point?
No.
No. How about this point?
No.
No. Because
is it part of the black end? Oh, it's on the dotted line, which is not part of the graph, really. And so, naturally, not there either. How about here?
No.
Yeah.
No.
Oh.
It's like double, though. It's not part of either graph.
Yeah.
Because it's on the dotted line, it's both of them. Only stuff in here would be a solution. If I had to graph it and I asked you, it's 4, 7, a solution to the inequality or the system of inequalities.
Yeah.
Say yeah, because it's clearly the overlapping blacked out halves. How many solutions are there?
Infinite.
Infinite number. There's just an infinite number in there, and it just keeps getting more and more as they both expand out that way. Grace?
Are we generally spots when it's first ordered?
Probably like on the 25th or so.
Why would you ask that when you look at the other stuff?
Let's just go over the basics of the problem, assuming you've read it. It's about a plane, and it's flying into the wind, and then with the wind, it says small plane takes off and heads directly upwind. That means, is the wind going this way, or is it going this way?
That way. The second.
This one?
Yeah.
If you fly upwind, it's blowing into your, it's like up river and down river, right? Something maybe you're more familiar with. So up river means I'm fighting, or sorry, upwind means I'm fighting the wind, and then the other way would be I'm getting help from the wind. Which is not surprising, because if you look at it, the return trip is faster, fully faster. And it would be faster if you were traveling with the wind as opposed to against the wind, right? Okay, so the first trip, the plane, straight plane, is flying this way, and the wind, right, is blowing this way, so slowing it down. Later, the plane is flying the other way, because it's returning. Yeah, we got really big. It's flying this way, and the wind is it out. Okay? Now, the plane itself, if the wind wasn't blowing, it would have taken the same amount of time either way, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it has a speed that is its speed, the airplane speed. The wind has a speed, right? when the airplane and the wind are going the same direction, what are their speeds doing to each other?
They're the same.
They're increasing each other.
Yeah, they're increasing each other. Exactly. The one, like the speed of the plane is increased by the speed of the wind. You can just add the two speeds together. If I'm flying this fast, and then this, you're running along. You can run at 12
miles an hour.
Is that?
I can run 37 miles per hour.
Full cross, really?
I have it. So let's say you can run 20 miles an hour, and the wind is blowing on your back, right, pushing you forward. It's going 10 miles an hour. Okay, then you go 30 miles an hour because it's helping you along. So if we call the speed of the plane x and the speed of the air y, speed of the plane is x, speed of the wind is y. Well, in here, they're being added together. Here, the speed of the plane is being reduced by the speed of the wind. The speed of the wind is taking away from the speed of the plane. Okay, well, I add the two speeds together, I should get the speed. Okay, this is the return trip. This is actually the second scenario. It says the return trip takes 10 minutes, and it's 10 miles away.
Did it take 10 plus 10?
Listen, the trip is 10 miles, right? 10 miles, either way, like from here to here is 10 miles.
He's going 100.
This time, it takes him 10 minutes to go that distance.
That's 60.
He's going.
It's what?
That's 60. 1 mile every minute.
Mile a minute, how many miles an hour?
100.
60.
Mile a minute, how many minutes in an hour?
60
miles an hour.
I don't know
what. Okay. Or we could say there's 10 miles divided by hours. Now they gave us 10 minutes. How much of an hour is 10 minutes?
1/6.
1/6 of an hour is 10 minutes. 1/6 of an hour. Divided by a fraction, multiplied by the reciprocal, we get 10 times 6. Also tells us 10 miles per hour. 10 miles per hour. Or sorry, 10 times 6 is not 10. It is 60. Okay, so we don't really know how fast the plane can go. We don't know how fast the wind is blowing. We can show that together they can transport people at 60 miles an hour. Very slow plane. Okay. Flying this direction into the wind when the wind is taking away from the plane, to go 10 miles it takes 60 minutes.
Okay.
How fast is that in miles per hour?
60 minutes in miles per hour?
10 miles. To go 10 miles in 60 minutes.
That's 10 miles an hour.
60 minutes is an hour, right? 10 miles in 1 hour, 10 miles an hour?
10 miles an hour.
There you have it. Two speeds add up to 60. The speed of the, if we take the speed of the wind away from the speed of the plane, it reduces it down to 10 miles an hour. And how do we solve the system?
You can do substitution, or you can just go ahead and do like minus.
Oh, I mean,
yeah.
Add them together. I would add them together because it's
because
never was there a better set of system of equations to do elimination with, right?
So I see both sides.
X equals 70? Yeah.
That's like
X
plus
and
X
y
equals,
both
oh,
2X
equals
70. 2X equals 70.
And then divided by 2.
35. So if X is 35, then I guess Y would have to do what?
0.
35?
Oh. 25? 25. 35 minus Y equals 10. Solve for Y. So the speed of the plane must be 35, slow plane, and the speed of the wind must be 25.
Can we do number 7 real quick, please?
7.
I just totally forgot how to do it.
Determine whether the given order pair is a solution to the system of equations.
Oh.
Thank you. Okay, we got a system of equations. Any equation, like this guy by itself, has limitless solutions, right? A solution is a pair of numbers, an x number and a y number, that would make the equation true. Two equations together might have shared solutions. They might have how many shared solutions?
One, zero, or infinity.
Remember them as graphs. The graphs can cross once, different slopes. They can cross no times because they're parallel. They have the same slope. They can cross at all points because it's the same line. So we're going to see, is this guy 3, negative 4, is it a solution to this system of equations? Now this might be the solution. It might be one of infinite solutions in it. Just might not be a solution at all. How do we check?
We plug in those 2 points and the y.
That's what the solution is. It makes the equation work. It makes both equations work, great. If it doesn't, I don't know. So negative four equals 2 times 3 minus 10. That's negative four. Is that equal to 6 minus 10? 6 minus 10? Negative four. So yes. So check. Got to fix the second equation. Negative 4 equals 3 times 3 minus 15. Negative 4 is 9 minus 15. Is that negative 4?
No, it's negative 6.
Is it negative 6? Did I write it down right?
Yeah.
So no, it's negative 6, and that's not true. So
no.
The answer would be no, right? At the very end. With that piece of it is just 3 fourths.
Okay, I got one more for you.
Okay. Oh, well, I know why it didn't work.
Because you put the wrong answer.
I put 3 negative 4, should have been 2, 10. I looked at 6. 2, 10 is over.
Huh, so it was the first.
That's funny, yeah. It doesn't work in the first one. 2 times 10 equals 2 times 2 minus 10.
No, false.
It's just right away. 4 minus 10 is negative 6, so it doesn't work. It doesn't even matter what happens to this equation. It's definitely not a solution to the system of equations.
I got one more.
Okay.
Number three.
Solve the system by substitution. Check your solution. For substitution, we're going to take y or x from one equation and replace it with something. How do we know what to replace it with? The other equation tells us. But neither equation is telling us that y is equal to a something or that x is equal to a something, but we can make it that way.
So then you do minus. Can we do that? Can we add that?
No, it says to use substitution specifically.
Oh. So minus 2x.
My recommendation would be, since this is already a positive 1y, it's easy to get by itself, so we could add x to both sides. So now we have the equation y equals x minus 5.
Well, I meant the top.
Right, I'm just trying to cut to the chase here and tell you what I would do. This would be the fastest way. Okay. To get this equation to be solved for y, one step to take. So now we know that y is equal to x minus 5, so this y here can be replaced with x minus 5.
Uh-huh.
So we'll do just that.
But
2x minus x minus 5 instead of y.
So
exactly the same, except for this y is replaced with an x minus 5. Distribute that negative. 2x minus x plus 5 equals negative 3. X subtract 5 from both sides equals negative 8. 2x minus x is x. Subtract 5 from both sides, x is negative 8.
Plug that in.
Plug it in. Y equals negative 8 minus 5. Y equals negative 13. Negative 8, negative 13.
Who said that? No, negative 8 is for the top one.
You can put it in here, you can put it in here. Any one of these equations is going to give you a y of negative 13. Let's put it
for being late.
You're going to take care of it.